In this video, we'll talk about content delivery networks. These are things which make your system cheaper and faster. So that's the end result. And to know about that, one of the prerequisites is to know about caching. Also, some knowledge about distributed systems is useful. So if you haven't gone through a high level of what a distributed system is or what caching is, then go through those videos first, then we come to this. So let's say some users want to connect to your website. I'll take interview ready as an example here. They first resolve the address with the DNS, then ask what www.interviewready.io maps to. They'll get an IP address. Now they try to connect to that IP address. So with a very simple system, we will keep a server here, which is going to serve web pages. So the page that you see rendered on your browser is going to be an HTML page, and that's going to be served by a machine called a server. Okay. The HTML pages are being stored in its file system, which it can read and return as a response. Since this is a common operation, you want to do this operation quickly. And so one of the things that you can use, a common concept in computer science, is caching. You can keep the web pages in memory, or you can keep them very close in local storage itself, instead of keeping it in a distributed file store. And when a person asks for a page, you just return it quickly. The problem with this approach is that to get a web page takes time. If a person is connecting from Japan, if a person is connecting from the US, if they're connecting from India, there is no single server which is going to be quick to connect to. So let's say you have the server in India and most of your clients are from India. For the Indians, this server is going to be reasonably fast. But for the Americans, they have to connect from across continents. So the latency for the page to be rendered on the browser is going to be very high. If you move it somewhere centrally, then both parties are not going to be too happy, and people in Japan may be quite unhappy, right? So there is no single place in the world where having a server is going to make everyone happy. It's going to cost latency to some of the parties. The second problem is that you may have local regulations which say that the data of this country is only going to be displayed in that country. For example, if you have certain movies that you can only show in India, you can't show that in the US, you can't show that in Japan, then you want some sort of local storage for that country. Similarly, US may have some movies which are allowed to be aired only in the US region, not in India. And so for these reasons, we can take our cache, the large cache that we had connecting to the server, and distribute it into smaller chunks around the globe. So content which is limited in Japan can be closer to NEN. Content which is limited to India can be closer to India, and so on. The benefit of this is that this is much faster. If the Americans want to connect to a page, they no longer have to go to a server in Japan. They can just connect to a local server. This is very important when you're running a business. If there's a delay of even half a second, most users, they lose a lot of trust. And this is two studies that Amazon and Google have done, that if you're able to render the web page quickly on the browser, people feel like this website is very professional. Okay, so speed is important. The second thing is that you may have some local regulations that we talked about. Those can be met individually in the local caches themselves, and you're able to serve content which is relevant to the user. So there may be movies which are popular in India, but are not so popular in the US. Since this is a cache, it can't store all the movies that you have in your file store behind. You're going to keep only relevant data in these local caches. Important thing to remember is that this cache is very similar to a server. It is actually a server. You can connect to that IP address, you can hit an API, and it's going to render the response. Okay, so it is running a server internally. It has a file system, and that file system can be manipulated by the mother server. This entire solution is called a CDN, or Content Delivery Network. CDNs usually are made by large companies because it's not easy to take your servers and distribute them all around the world. It's definitely not easy to do this in a way that you can make a business out of it, because the servers have to be cheap so that you can charge businesses less. And they also have to be fast so that your customers are happy. The best CDN solutions provide three things. One is that they have boxes in many places close to their potential clients. They're able to follow the regulations quite well. So you don't have to, as a business, create these rule engines. The CDN is quite efficient at that. And the content updation in the CDN is usually easy. If you see the HTML pages, that section over here, the server doesn't really want to make an HTML page and then let the CDN know. It ideally wants to just put it in the store and have it event triggered automatically. One example of a CDN will be Amazon CloudFront. It's cheap, It's reliable. It's easy to use. We actually use it at Interview Ready, so I can kind of vouch for it. The best thing about, I think, CloudFront is that it has integration with Amazon S3, where you just have to make a new file and the event is triggered. As an engineer, you don't have to manage this. So most cloud solutions like GCP, Azure will give you this anyway. All you have to do is think about what data you want to send to the CDN. Usually this data is static data, like videos, images, files. So that's it. That is a content delivery network. It is a black box which stores static content close to all of your clients. It's usually very cheap and very, very efficient for fast data access.